कॉल करो।
गुड मॉर्निंग मैम, अर्चना मंत्री मैम, वेरी वार्म वेलकम एंड अ गुड मॉर्निंग टू यू। गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल अदर हु हैव जॉइंड अस टुडे। आई आल्सो टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू गुड मॉर्निंग जादव सर आल्सो। एंड इन आवर सीरीज ऑफ एक्टिविटीज व्हिच वी आर डूइंग टुवर्ड्स प्रमोटिंग द वर्कशॉप रिफॉर्म्स, इन फैक्ट सेंसिटाइजिंग वेरियस फैकल्टी मेंबर्स ऑन द सब्जेक्ट, यस्टरडे ईच वन ऑफ यू वर briefed about the various processes towards the examination and the activities, and in continuation to that series we would be having Archana Mantri ma'am, the honorable vice chancellor sir, Chitkara University, briefing today about the Bloom's taxonomy towards assessment of learning outcomes. Now this is a very relevant and an important subject as it pertains to each one of us towards designing question papers or towards framing assessment parameters in such a manner that students are in a position to be assessed and judged. And remember, at the end of the day, all these activities are towards making them a better individual for the purposes of employment, not only within the country but anywhere as comparable in the outside world also. That is what is the whole purpose for which we are going ahead with this series of webinars on the subject. And all the participants, welcome to you also, that you people have logged on. Today would be the day that at the end of the session, from my office, you people would be given a Google form, and that Google form would be in such a manner that you would be required to frame your questions based on the topics which have been briefed to you on various Bloom's taxonomy level difficulties. And then you will have to be presenting that tomorrow morning. That is how we sequentially go about. So request maximum participants to reply to the Google form so that you would be made as panelists for tomorrow, and then the discussion will be generated on moderation of your framed question paper. Archana Mantri ma'am, over to you for commencement of today's proceedings, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Colonel Venkat. Just to give you a brief about yesterday's assignment, a brief assignment that we had posted and the quiz, out of 1,000 participants, almost 800 have responded already, which means that the participants were very engaged, highly engaged, and they were very responsive. And I'm so happy to be receiving this kind of response in an online workshop. That is kudos to AICT and its initiatives. Thank you, sir.
Most welcome, ma'am. All your effort. Absolutely your effort, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. So we start with today's proceedings on the workshop. And as you know, this particular workshop is for 3 days. That is, it started yesterday and will go on till tomorrow. Today, session one, day two, is on use of Bloom's taxonomy for assessing learning outcomes. So just to recap, the whole objective of this workshop is to walk you through the stepwise procedure proposed in the policy document, which is available on AICT website and has been framed by very eminent educationalists drawn across the country. And then at the end of this workshop, the participants, that is you will be able to design assessments at all levels of Bloom's taxonomy. And as Colonel Venkat has already pointed out, that you will be given an assignment today, wherein you will be designing your own complete question paper. Also, to assess the attainment of program outcomes based on principles of outcome-based education, we will be eventually sharing some examples, model question papers, and also the mapping of Bloom's taxonomy, course outcomes, performance indicators, mapped to all the questions or test items, as you call it. So this is the whole walkthrough, objective and outcome of the workshop, a recap. This is again a recap of the outline of the total 3-day workshop. And as you can see, we are here on day two, session three, that is use of Bloom's taxonomy for design of questions. And we will also practice some examples on changing Bloom's taxonomy levels of questions. So here comes poll question one. All of you kindly be ready to respond to this poll question one. If you attended day one of this workshop, whether you attended or you attended just session one or just session two, or you attended both the sessions, kindly respond. Out of the total participants presented today, kindly respond to this poll. All right, Shwani ma'am, we can close the poll now. Let us look at the response. All right, so it's quite a mixed demography. 48 of you are new entrants here. All right, so which means you must, the next two slides will be important for you, wherein I have given the summary of session one and session two. Those of you who could attend only session one, that is 39 of you, kindly do see again the summary slides, and also those who could attend only session two. 351 of you have attended both the session, that's good. So the maximum gain will be for those people who have attended both the sessions yesterday. And 276 of you have not responded. That's okay. So which means majority of you have attended, but quite a few of you have also attended either of the sessions. Nevertheless, we proceed. And here are the summary of session one. We talked about, we actually deliberated upon why the examination reforms are necessary. The context setting was session one, and the reasons that we found out that why reforms in the examinations are important is that traditional examinations carry least priority in curricular domains. We also made a point yesterday that when it comes to designing content and objectives and course handouts, our enthusiasm levels are very high, and we bring in a lot of new stuff over there. But when it comes to preparing examinations, we just pick questions from here and there and use it as a means of grading our students. And that is why, and since the examinations are much more than that, assessments and examinations, that is why the reforms in examination, and above all, the mindset change in the teachers, is very important so far as examinations are concerned. We also recalled some common mistakes in designing assessments. Are we making the examinations too complicated or difficult, or we are making them low level to test only a few of the learning outcomes, or just to test the content, not the learning objectives? These are some of the common pitfalls or mistakes that we make in designing assessments. There are various motivations of the students that come to our class, and there is different motivation of the teachers that go to the class to teach the same set of students. So how do we align different approaches and motivations so that the students perform in the tests that we have designed, and also how to test the right set of skills and objectives and knowledge in the tests is something that we need to realign ourselves as per the motivation of the students present here. So this was all that we discussed in session one. In session two, a detailed discussion on outcome-based education, the reforms that outcome-based education can bring into the education system, specifically engineering education as per the Washington Accord, were discussed in detail by Professor Jadhav, and we talked about various performance indicators, competencies associated with the outcomes, and how to measure those competencies and achievement of learning objectives using performance indicators were discussed in detail. So this was the summary of day one. Today, in the session three, we are going to, at the end of this session, you, the participants, you will be able to write appropriate set of course learning objectives or outcomes using Bloom's taxonomy and keywords. And at least one set of questions you will be able to prepare during the session for your course, which can test high level of knowledge. These two are the outcomes of the session we are going to achieve. There will be an associated assignment at the end of the day, which you will have to complete, as Colonel Venkat has already pointed out. The outline is, we will first go through the taxonomy and keywords to write the CLOs. Then we will use the taxonomy and keywords to write the assessments, or assessment tools, or as we call test items. We will also practice and see some examples on how we can increase the levels of questions to higher level of taxonomy. All these are important tools in the hands of the teachers when it comes to curricular design, or when we call curricular experiences or learning experiences when we design it for our students. So let's proceed looking at the outcome and outline of session three. You might be appreciating that this is quite in line with the two sessions that we attended yesterday. We will do some quick reality checks because unless we ask questions, we are not engineers. So let's do some quick reality checks and then proceed further after establishing the needs of use of Bloom's taxonomy in writing assessments and course learning objectives. Let's brainstorm, not with each other, but with yourself, what our students do in the class and what they need to do at work. I'll leave you with yourselves for about 30 seconds or maybe 1 minute to think about at least 2 to 3 points that you can bring out a contrast in what the students do in the class usually and what they need to do at work. I'll leave you for a minute silent with yourself. Think about it. You do not need to write anything in the chat window. Think about it. If you have access to a pen and paper, you can write it, or on your screens yourselves, you can write it on a Word document. What students do in the class and what they need to do at work. Any contrast that you can bring out, please do so. A few of you are writing in the chat box. You can keep on doing so, but there is no need. I want you to think, reflect, and write in your own notes. Talk to yourself. Okay, so I'm sure you must have been able to bring out some contrast in what the students do in the class and what they need to do at work. That was reality check one. Let's come to reality check two. And that is, how much do we teach in our class and how much our students are able to understand, retain, connect, and apply. Again, I do not want you to write anything, but just be there with yourself for about next 30 seconds and think of, is there a perfect balance that you are able to achieve, or there is a contrast? Remember, there is no perfect answer to these questions. It's a kind of reflection that you are doing on your own teaching and your students' learning. The class scenarios that we daily are into in our daily lives. So we need to find out what is the context, what is the scenario, what is the reality of our classes. It's a reflection that you want to do on your own teaching. And final reality check is this, that the students come with different abilities, different motivation, different learning styles, and different background to your class. No two students are same. If they are same in their abilities, they might be different in their motivation. If they are same in their abilities and motivation, they may be different in their learning styles. And if all the three are same for any two given students, their background might be different. So if there is a heterogeneous class that you are teaching and you are one who are teaching to them with your own teaching style, with your own preferences. So these are some of the reality checks that you need to do in your class as one versus many or many versus one. Some kind of reflection, some kind of context setting, some kind of scenario, some kind of reality checks. Having done that, I'm not asking any answers because there is no perfect answer, just a realization of the scenarios that we are present. We move on to Bloom's taxonomy straight. I know yesterday when I asked that question that how many of you have heard the terms outcome-based education, Bloom's taxonomy, course learning outcomes or program outcomes, all that stuff, and people, almost 98% of you responded that you have heard all these terms, which means I'm assuming that out of the total participants present here, all of you must have seen or heard about Bloom's taxonomy sometime or the other. I also know that many of you might be practicing it already in one way or the other in your classes. What I want to reemphasize here and recap here and tell you here is that Bloom's taxonomy is something which is not to be used only for framing your course handouts or learning objectives or only for designing your assessments. Bloom's taxonomy has a clear-cut connection, and there is a clear-cut connection, and if you have not practiced it, please start doing so right away. The learner's triangle we discussed yesterday. We also discussed that the whole design of learning experiences, or curricular design as we call it, cannot be one after the other, which means that it's not possible to think about instruction without thinking about assessment and objectives. It is impossible to think about objectives without thinking about instructions and assessments. The same way, if you are thinking of Bloom's taxonomy, it is to be thought, co-thought at all levels in all the three vertices or very important parameters of designing of learning experiences. So not only Bloom's taxonomy is used to design the assessments, but it should also be used to design the learning objectives, but it should also be used to design your instructions. That is what is the framework that taxonomy provides us, given by the eminent educationalist, education theorist, Bloom, that this is the backbone. And remember, the levels which are given here, they are cognitive domains. The way people think and build knowledge is known as cognition. And by human psychology, these are the six levels of thinking and cognition and building knowledge that each one of us possesses. So your students. Hence, think of Bloom's taxonomy at all three vertices, all the three levels, all the three parameters of designing the learning experiences. So how do we co-design the assessment and pedagogy? The question comes, is that? And how do we co-design, going one step further, assessment, pedagogy, and objectives? So ask yourself these questions. What enabling knowledge and skills are required? What activities? Remember, each of these questions can be placed in one of the vertices of the triangle that I just flashed on the last slide. What enabling knowledge and skills are required? When do you ask this question? You ask this question when you frame your learning objectives or course outcomes, as we call it. What activities will equip them with knowledge and skills? Pedagogy. What and how to be taught in light of performance goals? Remember, we talked about performance indicators in the last session, that is session 2. So performance goals, can they be linked to objectives? And finally, those activities need to be linked to your teaching. So everything is related to the other. When you ask yourself these questions and then design the learning experiences for your students, everything is coherent. You will recall that we also talked about coherency of design on day one. What materials and resources are needed? And what assessment strategy is needed? Because each one of these are to be co-thought. Is the overall design coherent and effective? That is how you co-design the whole learner's triangle and the curricular and learning experiences for your students. Nothing comes one after the other. And when you think about them, you think about taxonomy of cognition. Because students need to achieve knowledge, gain knowledge, acquire skills at the highest level of taxonomy, that's your responsibility. It's not the sole responsibility of your students, it's also the responsibility of you as a teacher. So the whole learning experiences need to be designed in tandem and keeping in mind the highest level of taxonomy. That's what is the importance of Bloom's taxonomy. Let's talk about this and deliberate for a moment on what are the hierarchy of learning objectives. All of you have already heard, discussed, made written course learning objectives many a times when you are teaching your courses. So, but it is very important that we also decide, devise, and write section, chapter, module level objectives also. You may not write it and share it with your students on a day-to-day basis. That's a disclaimer that I'm putting, and it's very important. But in your own minds, you should be able to decide and write these outcomes and objectives. There is an analogy right away in front of you. At the beginning of the session, I shared with you the workshop outcomes and objectives. Did I? Yes, I did. But I also shared with you each session's objectives and outcomes also. Did I? Yes, I did. That is what is the importance of section, chapter, module levels objectives. The students and the teachers should be very clear that at the end of this session, this module, this chapter, as a student, I will be able to learn all these knowledge and skills. At what level? That also should be specified. Similarly, at individual lecture level. So in the next 1 hour, what my participants in this workshop will be able to learn. At the end of the day, what my participants will be able to learn, important. At the end of the workshop, my participants will be able to learn this much, important. All the three things are important. Because everything is hierarchical in nature, and everything leads to the other at a higher level. Those achievements are important. Unless you achieve the very low level of objectives, you will not be able to achieve the higher level. So think about this, break down your whole course into these hierarchy of objectives, lecture level, module level, and the course level, and keep on achieving them, and your students also, at each level, they should be able to achieve it. This is a repetition from session 2, wherein Professor Jadhav already told you when he was talking about program outcomes and course learning course outcomes, that when you are writing the course outcomes, I am repeating it here because this is directly related to Bloom's taxonomy. You have to use action words and avoid words like understand, appreciate, all those things should be avoided. Why? Simply for the simple reason that understanding, appreciating, these are not specific and measurable action words. They can be important goals for your course, but they are certainly not objectives or outcomes. Use specific action words. Which action words? We will now elaborate and discuss it in more detail in the subsequent about say 15-20 minutes. We are going to discuss that. So I'm picking the threads from where Professor Jadhav left yesterday in session 2 and elaborated further for the benefit of the participants. Let's look at Bloom's taxonomy in detail. You might be knowing it already, but it is always good to revisit because it is so important. The backbone of the whole education and learning experiences, it is always good to revisit, recall, recap, reinforce everything related to Bloom's taxonomy and use it. Because remember, in the last 10 minutes, what we have actually emphasized is that Bloom's taxonomy is to be used for all the three important vertices of the learning triangle. So let's look and put this perspective in terms of thinking about Bloom's taxonomy. So clearly, analyzing, evaluating, and creating are higher order skills that your students should be able to achieve. And lower order skills, which are remembering, understanding, applying, these also are very important parameters, because unless you or your students are able to remember, understand, and apply, they will not be able to analyze, evaluate, and create. You all would understand. And that is how the cognition takes place, the knowledge building thinking takes place in human mind. And building knowledge and skills is nothing but a whole gamut of cognition, and hence Bloom's taxonomy. So there are some related explanations given there. Remembering is about recalling facts, definitions, replicate, known solutions, procedures. Explain, interpret, classify, compare terms, observations, concepts. These are the levels of understanding. They all fall at the level of understanding on taxonomy. Finally, at applying level, it is to know procedures to novel problems. So there is a problem at hand, but there is also an example at hand. So the human mind recalls the example, how we have solved that problem and how this problem at hand can be solved. That is how the human mind applies previous knowledge to the new problem at hand. When it comes to analysis, there are two more important parameters that get introduced, that is interpret and predict. Evaluation requires all these applying, analyzing, understanding kinds of levels to evaluate, to introduce new parameters, to use those new parameters to prioritize in human mind. Those are evaluation level of cognition. And finally, when the human mind is able to create using all the skills, the motor skills, all the domains of education or human mind, then the student is able to design, plan, create, and formulate. Troubleshooting, by the way, falls at analyzing and evaluating levels. All these are important, very important parameters of cognition and should be built using Bloom's taxonomy in all the learning experiences that you design for your students. So you may ask, what are the levels that I should introduce in my teaching? Should I not introduce the lower levels? I'll leave that to you, at least for the moment, to answer that question. Should I address only higher levels and teach only higher levels and test only higher levels of taxonomy in the class? The answer is, ideally, all levels should be addressed. And ideally, all levels should be assessed. The question remains, the catch is when. If I go back to these levels, we have established the fact that all the levels should be taught, all the levels should be addressed, all the levels should be assessed. But we did not deliberate upon when those levels should be assessed. It will come clear in the next few minutes. Remember, in session one yesterday, we talked about why, how, who, when, what of assessments. Did we? Most of you would recall that we did. And there was a very important parameter there, when. When do you need to place an assessment in the whole curricular design is also important. I'll make a statement here and then proceed forward to deliberate it later. If you are asking definitions in the end-term examination, and if you are asking definitions in a class test, very different contexts. But the importance of placing the definition assessment in the class is more than placing it in end-term examination. You see, end-term examination is more of a summative assessment of your student's knowledge. If the student at that point of time in end-term examination doesn't know the definition of a particular term, he or she is anyways doomed. But if he doesn't know or is not able to recall the definition of a particular term in a class test, there is still scope for him or her to learn and understand that definition. So put the definition or lower levels of taxonomy assessments in class and sessional tests, assignments, rather than lower levels being assessed in the end-term examination. I'll leave you with this thought here and proceed further. But I'll repeat before proceeding. I said that lower levels of taxonomy or lower levels of knowledge taxonomy assessments, we should put in the formative assessment, and higher levels of taxonomy judgment and assessments, we should put at the end, towards the end of the course. Because remember, all the lower levels of cognition are necessary for a student to go and build higher levels of cognition. So when should they be tested? The lower levels, obviously, when the cognition is getting built, you should put it there, make it more of a part of your formative assessment. And towards the summative assessment, higher levels of assessment, you put higher levels of taxonomy questions. I hope you would agree, and even if you disagree, it's fine. Very important, which is put in here in red, is students will rise to challenge, make expectations clear. If you are making the expectation that higher levels of assessments, higher levels of knowledge will be assessed and will be taught and will be made a part of the whole objectives of the course or course outcomes, the students will rise to the challenge. If the students know that my end-term examinations will always be, my assignments will always be definitions and derivations, they will always be intended not to come to your class, but only to copy and reproduce. So you can make your expectations clear to the students, and the students will eventually rise to the challenge. Think about it. We have already talked about these levels, but an important point I will recap here from session two again, that it is almost impossible, equivalent to difficult, to assess evaluation and creation kind of levels in written examinations. It's very difficult. I'll not say impossible. Okay, I'll rephrase the words. It's not impossible, but it's high level of difficulty if you want to evaluate, create an evaluation in written examinations. So examinations assignments should be limited to the first four levels of taxonomy. And applying, and of course, there is an overlap, as you can see there. There is an overlap that you can see that applying, analyzing fall in both examination assignments category and also projects, seminars, case studies, industrial training, and internships. So those levels can be assessed more using case studies, seminars, and projects, and the lower levels can be assessed more towards assignment. And that is why when in session four today, you will be deliberating and discussing with the resource person about assessment planning, it is very important to introduce various components and types of assessments in a typical course. Do not make the assessments only quizzes, only open book tests, only written tests, only assignments, only end-term examinations. Make it a combination. Because as the theory is putting it right in front of you by this slide, that it is not possible to assess all the levels using one type of instrument. That is test instrument we are talking of. And ideally, all levels should be addressed in a course. We have already discussed that. So hence, we conclude that we should include variety of assessment tools in our any given typical course. That is what will also be deliberated and discussed in more detail in session 4. Let's look at some sample questions as we deliberate and discuss of all the 6 levels of taxonomy. So remembering is about retrieving, recognizing, recalling relevant knowledge from long-term memory. There are some keywords you will find in the subsequent 6 slides. There are some keywords which have been put on this peach colored box. So you can use the keywords like list, define, tell, describe, recite, recall, identify, show, label, tabulate, quote, name, who, when, where. All these are also available in standard literature. You can go to Google it. You can go to any standard literature, paper, textbooks, where all these keywords have already been given. Use them to write low level or remembering level of questions. There are some sample questions which are also given here. So state Ohm's law, list the physical and chemical properties of silicon, list the components of A2D converter. I'm not saying they are not important questions. They are important questions, assessment tools, test items, whatever you can call in order to test the remembering level of the students. But as I said already, move and place these kinds of questions more in class assessments, quizzes, short-term assignments. All these should be limited to those places because they are important, but they do not judge or assess the high level of understanding. So think of this, unless a student would know and understand Ohm's law, he or she will not be able to solve problems or application level problems later on. So it is important for him or her to state Ohm's law, but also understand that stating Ohm's law is not end of the knowledge. It's only beginning. So put it, this assessment, put it somewhere which really requires for him or her to build knowledge. When is important? Where you are going to place these components. Understanding is constructing meaning from oral, written, graphic messages through interpreting, exemplifying, classifying, summarizing, inferring, comparing, and explaining. Here are some of the questions that you can see. So explaining, there is some reasoning here. How does a PN junction diode behave under different bias conditions? So understanding is important. Not only recalling, but also understanding is important. When you are asking somebody to describe, then also just simple recalling doesn't only serve the purpose, because the characteristics of SCR and transistor equivalent to SCR, these two are different things, and one has to understand that level of understanding has to be achieved in student's mind before he or she answers this question. Explaining, discussing, all these are important, I would say, keywords to judge or assess the understanding level of your students. Let's proceed to applying. And as you can see, the length of the question statements is also increasing in proportion to the levels of taxonomy as we are moving up the ladder. Because in application scenarios, you need to contextualize a particular problem. And that is why the context setting and scenario building takes more words. And you can see here, I leave you with this slide for about 15 seconds for you to read through and reflect yourself how these questions are actually qualify themselves to be at the application level. The key parameter, the key keywords or the action verbs are also given in the peach box there. I'll leave it with you for 15 seconds. And before I proceed further, just two disclaimers. I know that all the participants are not from electronics, not from mechanical, not from civil engineering domains. You all are belonging to different domains. Don't think that I am not going to read this question because simply because I do not belong to that domain. The idea here is all of us are engineers. That much multidisciplinary knowledge we all possess, and we all know the whole idea of this workshop is to look at the structure of the questions, understand the scenarios, how the questions are getting built, because they are important test items in your assessments. Contextualize these questions in your own courses, and you will be able to draw conclusions that how this particular question is lying or qualifying itself to be at that level. So this is the application level. Let's move to analyze. So when you are asking the students to analyze, it's an important, I would say, indication that I want to give here is to break the material into constituent parts and then determine, ask your students to determine how those parts are related to one another. Engineering problems, whenever we curate them, whether in real life scenarios or in educational scenarios, it's very important to think of the whole problem in smaller chunks and finally apply integration principles to build the solution. And that is what you do in analyzing part. Even most of the time when you are teaching and facilitating and mentoring your students on the analysis part of it, you do it this way unconsciously. So when you are assessing your students on the analysis part, do the same thing. These are some questions on analysis and then evaluation and creation. And as I said, evaluation and creation can only be done leaving the questions to be open-ended. There cannot be, when you are asking your students to evaluate and create, there cannot be one perfect solution for the problem at hand. And open-ended problems definitely and most beautifully qualify to these kinds of assessments at the levels of evaluation and creation. So look at the first problem itself. It's so open-ended. The students, if there are 50 students in the class, there could be 15 designs, different designs that they can submit as a solution to this problem. And then as a teacher, you need to evaluate all those designs on the parameters, because here, the only parameter which is given in this problem is that in the third statement, in the third sentence of the first problem, that the milking process involves attaching the milking cups to the teats, which means there should be enough suction, there should be enough suction for the milk to be extracted. And that is the only parameter. Now, how much is all those parameters need to be thought by the students and need to be, then they have to come up with a design. So it's quite open-ended, fairly open-ended problem for the students to come up with a design. Similarly, the other two questions, you will see that there are enough parameters for them to play around, to design a system, to create a system, And also they are using their evaluation skills. They are using various formulae to actually come up to that design level. So these are some of the problems that can qualify at those levels. Finally, we have been talking about cognition, knowledge building, skill building, how these two cognition dimension, as we call it, and knowledge dimension fit to each other. And you will appreciate that here there is a two-dimensional matrix which have been given. And the reference, the citation, from where it has been extracted has also been given in this slide, but you will appreciate that how the cognition, the remembering, understanding, applying, analyzing, evaluating, and creating is related on the four-pronged dimension of the knowledge. So when the students are building factual knowledge on these six levels of cognition, these are some of the keywords that you can use. So listing, if you want your students to list, if you want your students to summarize, to respond, to select, to check, and finally to generate, you are addressing the creation level at factual level. When you are asking your students to generate something, then they are actually recalling, they are actually building their factual knowledge dimension, but at the level of creation. Go further, that is on the conceptual level. Then let us pick the differentiate keyword, and you will appreciate that at the analysis level, if you want to build or assess the conceptual level of the students, conceptual knowledge on analysis level, then you would ask them to differentiate, and so on. So creation, you will see here, the word create sits at the highest level of knowledge, that is metacognitive, and at the creation level of cognition level. So knowledge dimension and cognition dimension are related to each other in this manner. That is what this slide shows. Again, there is a lot to reflect, lot to think, lot to practice based on this two-way matrix which has been shown here. And it is for you to practice and think and design your assessments using the keywords which have been shown earlier, and you can extract them from the literature also. And using this knowledge dimension and cognition dimension for you to design your assessments. So in a way, in a nutshell, what we are trying to say here is that when you are designing your assessments, your learning experiences, your pedagogy and your objectives, you need to take care of all these dimensions together, but at various points in the whole, I would say, spatial domain or in the time domain. So think of it, your course design, as a four-dimension problem, wherein space, time, knowledge, and cognition are the four dimensions of the whole curricular design process. I'll repeat: space, time, knowledge, and cognition. The four dimensions of the experiences that you would build for your students using the curricular design practices that you have just now learned. So assessments, very important, because assessments drive learning. We have been reinforcing the statement again and again. Do not leave assessments to chances, to just as a least priority task in your whole curricular design process. Assessments are very important. Now, at this point, we are going to launch some poll questions, because I want you to test your skills on your judgment where these questions fit in. And as I said, and I'll put the disclaimer once again, the questions can be drawn which I'm going to put in the poll questions now, they can be drawn from any domain or any discipline of engineering. You have to just look at the structure of the question and use your judgment to find out at which level of Bloom's taxonomy they are fitting in. So let's launch the first question, which is this. You have about 3 to 4 minutes to read this question and then tick one of the levels of taxonomy where you think it fits the most. Shivani ma'am, as soon as about 70% of them have responded, please close the poll.
Sure, ma'am.
If you have closed the poll, please share the results.
Results shared, ma'am.
I cannot see them now. Okay, so 219, that is the maximum number, have responded that it is at analysis level, 77 at evaluation level, and 59 of you say that it is at the creation level. So clearly, this particular question is at the higher levels of taxonomy, because the second statement says that. I'll just close this from here. Yeah, the second statement says that suggest some basic steps to be undertaken so that the problem can be resolved. Please note that suggested solutions should not be cost efficient, should be cost efficient and not draw total expenditure of more than 10,000 per junction. This clearly is at a very high level of taxonomy. Analysis, evaluation, both are involved in this particular question. So those of you who have responded for analysis and analysis and evaluation level, they are right. Creation is also, it may be right because there could be there people, there might be students who may suggest some new steps which have not been existing so far. So what I'm trying to say here is that it's not important for you to decide the right level of taxonomy wherein a particular question can be placed. But because as I said already, that lower levels are always involved when you are asking a question at a higher level of taxonomy. So creation would always require some or the other steps of analysis and application levels. Analysis would always require students to apply knowledge to understand. So it's okay. Whatever highest level you can identify, it is perfectly fine. In my opinion, this question perfectly fits in at analysis and evaluation level. But there is no one perfect answer for your understanding of this question of the taxonomy level. And it is also not important to fit in at the right level of taxonomy. It's just important to know that a question requires the students to think at a higher level. Let's go to the next poll question. And the next question, which is this. Can we launch the next poll, Shivani ma'am? Again, you are required to recognize the level of this question at the sixth level of taxonomy. I'll again recap and reinforce and want to recall that it's not important for you to belong to a particular discipline or area for you to respond. Just look at the structure of the question and think of yourself, because people in the chat window have written that we are from management domain, we are from pharmacy domain, it's okay. There is a little typo there in the last sentence. Read then instead of 10. Mind it, those of you who choose to not respond, they will not be able to achieve the outcomes of this workshop. It's not only important to listen and look at the material at the workshop that you are attending, but also practice what you have learned. Unless you experience test yourself, you will not be able to achieve all the outcomes of this workshop. Then this workshop will be just a certificate for you. It's your choice. You want to just earn the certificate or you want to learn from this workshop. So please do try your hands at the polls, at the exercises, at the assignments which are being given. There is no right and wrong here, but it is important for you to learn. So right now, when I'm seeing the response, 401 of you have not responded, which means you are here only to earn a certificate. It's okay. It doesn't matter to me because we are anyway conducting the workshop, but it should matter to you. So yes, 318 of you have responded that it is at the creation level, which is right. Those of you, I would not say those of you are saying at the remembering level. Yes, it requires the people to remember what does USP CMOS systems relate to. Yes, only that much portion is at the remembering level, but the whole purpose of this question is that the student should respond with a creation of a system for that particular application. So definitely this particular question rests at the creation level, which is at the highest level of taxonomy. Let's proceed to the next question, and I want all of you to answer, unless you are here only to earn a certificate. Let's respond and recognize the level of this question. You can close the poll, Shivani ma'am, and share the responses. Yes, this is like a perfect balance of people. There are equal number, almost equal number at apply, analyze, evaluate, create. And but maximum of you are saying at the evaluation level. I would agree with all of you because here there are many statements which actually puts it at different levels. You will see here there are many parts to this question. You will see that what essential steps you will take into consideration for design of such a circuit block. So this is at the analysis level. Do you need any more piece of data to suggest the complete design? Again, analysis level. If yes, what other information you will need and assume some typical values at the evaluation level. Also, this last two statements are putting it at the evaluation level, but the last statement, which has the word design, a complete circuit block, puts it at the creation level also. So this particular question is a good combination of analysis, evaluation, and design, all combined into one. And when we will discuss in the next session about the rubric also, this particular question, the rubric for this question can also be framed such that those students who respond to only the first part of the question, they can be given certain marks. Those who respond to two parts of the question, first question and second question, they can be given slightly higher marks. And finally, those students who are able to complete a design, complete design, they can be given maximum marks. So that is what is the beauty of this question, that not only it is at the highest level of taxonomy, but it is also at a graded level of the taxonomy. So that is how also you can frame your questions. I will skip rest of the polls in the interest of time, because there were some more questions where you were required to assess the level of the taxonomy, but we will just skip them. We will not launch the poll, but I will still scroll through the slides for you to look at the questions. So a simple question like write blah, 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 truth table and symbols for this and this. I'm not asking you to respond, but because we will not launch the poll, we have less time left. Discuss the effect of Make in India initiative on Indian manufacturing industry. Find out what will be the electricity bill if all these parameters are given. What is the energy band gap? So now we are coming to a very important part of this whole session, which is how to raise the level of a question statement. What you see here is one concept, which is the Newton's law of motion, and different questions framed on various levels of taxonomy. I leave you here for a minute for you to read all these questions, and then for next 1 minute we will discuss. But first of all, it is important for you to read through. Sorry. All of us have studied Newton's law of motion, laws of motion in our 11th, 10th, 11th, 12th classes in our school time. So even for people from management and pharmacy background would appreciate that this particular question, this particular concept of Newton's law of motion, how it can be asked at various levels of taxonomy to assess the understanding, the cognition level, the knowledge level of the students at six different levels. Look at the remembering level, wherein the teacher is asking the students to write the Newton's law of motion. That is the lowest level. And look at the creation level. I need not to even explain, and it is so beautifully, whosoever has made this example, it so beautifully gives the contrast how we can stepwise raise the level of a question of the same concept, but asked to judge or assess the highest level of taxonomy, a student's understanding. So discuss the Newton's law of motion with an example, that is at the understanding level. At the application level, when you are asking him to derive the equation of motion of a rigid body. So here is a scenario. In application, as I said, always a scenario or a real life application is given. So motion of a rigid body is that scenario and subjected to n forces, and then the student is asked to derive the equation. Analysis, derive the equation of motion of a spring damper system using Newton's laws. So Newton's laws is something that the student should be able to apply and analyze in a situation of a spring damper system. Then evaluate wherein a lifting mechanism is to be suggested to lift a load of 100 tons and suggest a mechanism that is safe, cost effective and easy to operate. Now, as you go up the levels of taxonomy, there is no one right answer for the question that you are asking. So it requires students to think more, to create more, to evaluate more, to apply more, to analyze more. And that is why it is important that you go to high levels of taxonomy. I am sharing with you some more examples here. Again, the domain is not important, discipline is not important, but the structure of the questions is important. Contextualize these question scenarios in your own course that you are teaching and think of how you can increase the levels of questions based on the single concept. By the way, just to tell you, inform you, pre-inform you that the end of this session, there is, we are going to share a Google Form link with you, wherein you have to write a question at a lower level of taxonomy in your own course. And also in the next section of that Google Form, you have to rewrite that concept, that question, increasing its level to higher level of taxonomy. That's going to be an exercise and assignment for you for the next 10 minutes at the end of this session. So I'm going to share with you some examples here on the slide and also share with you a link of the Google Form, which we are going to drop in the chat window. And you can start doing the exercise or you can look at the slides, whatever you feel like. Another example drawn from electronics domain. Shivani ma'am, if you are dropping the Google Form link in the chat window. Yes, I've already posted. Thank you. One more example from the topic of projectile. By the way, some beautiful examples have also been given in the policy document on examination reforms, which have been shared on the AICT website. You can also take cues from there. You can also download that document from there. There are also some examples given there. Some of them are given here. If you don't want to respond to the Google Form, you want to take time, that is also okay. You can take time and at leisure, you can fill up that Google Form wherein you are being asked to raise the level of a question in your own course to the next level. One more example. So now that we have discussed and deliberated how important it is for us to assess the students on the higher levels of taxonomy, not only cognitive domain, but also knowledge dimension, we have also discussed about how important it is for us to design curricular processes curricular experiences, learning experiences in the four dimensions of space, time, knowledge, and cognition. We now come up to the last portion of this session, which is about general suggestions for setting up good assessments. So, since we said that learning experiences, the learner's triangle, all the three vertices, important parameters are co-placed, when you are designing your assessments, you need to review learning objectives of the course. Do not review, do not keep in mind just the content, the topic, the syllabus, but the learning objectives. What are the knowledge and skills which is important for your students to gain at the end of this course? Test understanding, not speed. Now, this is something where people have different school of thoughts. When we are saying that the students need to be assessed at higher levels of taxonomy, which is analysis, application, design, creation, how can we limit the time of tests? But at the same time, we cannot open the test for infinite time. That is for you to find the trade-off in various kinds of assessment tools that you are using. When you are giving the students to design something, create something, giving a mini project, give them fairly enough time for them to actually create something good. The last statement in the brackets, who would you rather have designed the bridges you drive across or planes you fly in? Those people who have been given just 2 days to design that bridge, or those people who have spent and taken all the parameters into consideration for, say, a week's time or 2 weeks time to design that bridge, which is robust enough, which is perfect enough design for us to drive our cars on. So, depending upon the level of the question, depending upon the level of the test, you must decide the time that is being given to the students to perform. So, very important when that particular assessment is being placed, how much time you are giving the students to perform. The third statement, it is very boring when you have all the text in front of you, isn't it? Similarly, it is very boring when the students look at a question paper or at a test which has only text in it. So include graphs, illustration, pictures, interpretations, videos also, I would say. These days there are a lot of examinations, assignments which are happening online. So give them the link of a video and ask them to interpret in terms of a voice message, audio clipping, text message, whatever it can be. So bring variety in terms of tests also. So if you are making a presentation, if you are making an illustration, if you are explaining anything to the students, and if it has only text, it becomes boring for the students. Don't you think it becomes boring for the students to look at a question paper which has all kinds of drab text only, write this, discuss this, describe this? They are not interested. They are not engaged. And if they are not engaged and interested, they will be writing boring stuff in their answer sheets, which will be very boring to check. So use graphs, illustrations, pictures, videos in your question papers also. Make it interesting. Remember, assessment drives learning. And your assessment instrument should also be interesting enough for the students to supplement to the body of knowledge that you build in your class. Also, do not hesitate to give your colleague or a graduate student to read through the test that you have designed for any clarity point that you are missing. Is it an ambiguous question that the student will not be able to understand? And then respond finally. Is there something, a parameter missing there? Is there an instrument or is there a information which is missing in the question? Please give somebody to recheck. Also revise. Do not give an unrevised, unchecked question paper to your student. Test also, not only question paper. Design tests to maximize learning, very important, because tests are the important parameters, the last leg. Usually you say so, if it is a summative assessment in your whole curricular design experience. The formative assessments definitely are interlaced through your courses. Solve the test before you administer. And remember, your students are going to take slightly more time than you to perform that test. So give them enough time. Too complicated, too difficult, too easy, those things can be decided in terms of the time that you give your students to perform. Also consider sharing test objectives. You normally share with your students course objectives, session objectives, lecture objectives, but you do not share with your students what is the upcoming test, which is going to be coming in the next week. What are the test objectives? Do your test objectives match with your course objectives, with your module objectives? If yes, they will be interested. So consider sharing test objectives also before an upcoming test. So you can tell them that the upcoming test, which is going to be a quiz, which is going to be shared with you in the next week, my only intention is to test your memory, your recalling ability, and they will be preparing for that, for those definitions, derivations, parameters, classification, listing only. But if your objective of an upcoming test, which is an open book test maybe, is to test their creation, analysis and application level, then they would prepare accordingly. So consider sharing test objectives before you share your test. And obviously, as I said, do repetitions when you are actually making your test to make it to that refined level. For making multiple choice questions, consider the destructors. It's very important that you reconsider the destructors when you are deciding your choices, when you are writing your choices. Remember Rinku, Rohan and Riaz in your class. The example that I gave you in session one. So have a portion of your test to discriminate between Rohan's, Riaz and Rinku's. If your test is made only for Rinku's to perform, Rohan's will not be interested. A level, B level, C level performances. So test should be made according to the abilities of the learners, not as per your ability. Okay, and with those, we are just coming to the summary part. As I said, Bloom's taxonomy is the framework, is the backbone of your whole design of curricular experiences, the learning experiences. The three vertices are very intricately woven and should be taken, the keywords should be taken for all designing your learning objectives, designing your instruction, designing your assessments, from the Bloom's taxonomy and the related keywords. At all levels of Bloom's taxonomy, you should be designing your curricular experiences. The COs should be designing to address higher levels. And your tests, when they are placed through the semester, through the course, should be at various levels of taxonomy. When you are making a very early level test, a quiz for your students in the first week or so, think about understanding, remembering. In the second, third week, when the students have gained enough knowledge, remember to go to understanding, applying levels. As you move towards the end semester, think of a mini project. Think about creating, evaluating. Think of open book test. Think of analysis, evaluation, creating an application. And write and share not only your session, module, course objectives, but also your assessment and test objectives. Finally, remember that assessments drive learning, and higher levels of taxonomy, if addressed in your assessments, they will drive the students to achieve better knowledge and skills. With those words, we come to the end of the session. the assignment, which is a Google form, which requires you to raise one of two of the questions of your existing question paper to a next level, has already been shared with you. You can practice it, drop your completed assignment by the end of the day. It's okay. We are going to check it. Although we know that there are 1,000 participants, but we also know, like yesterday, there were 800 responses to the assignment and quiz that we submitted, which is excellent, by the way. But I also want all 1,000 of you should respond to these assignments, because it is for you to learn better, not only to earn a certificate. Thank you very much. Have a good day. We are going to have a 15 minutes break before we move to the session 4, which is going to be taken by Dr. Professor Jadhav. Thank you very much. Have a nice day ahead.
So very good afternoon all the participants, and I assume that most of the participants have joined back to the session. And I am extremely thankful for our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Archana Mantri, who has set again a very well, you can say, defined stage for me, so that I can basically put some building blocks on that. The foundation is already laid by Professor Mantri for this assessment planning and rubric. So welcome again to the session four of this workshop on examination reforms, day two, assessment planning and rubric. So our flow of session will be like this. We'll be having just a quick recap of what we have discussed yesterday in session one and session two. And then I'll discuss something about the quiz responses that Professor Mantri has already appreciated your contribution and involvement in the quiz responses. And assignment also, few of them have submitted the assignment. I have gone through some of the assignments that we have received. All I could not walk through, but there are some, about 100-150 assignments that we have received in our folder. And I assume that the others who could not complete the assignment on the critiquing performance indicator and competencies, they will submit in due course. And some of you was putting in chat box that the link that was not available, you missed that link, but we'll again put that link once again. I'll request Shivani ma'am to put the link of folder of our drive so that you can submit the assignments, those who could not submit and they have completed. Then after discussing the responses of the quiz that you have submitted, because whenever in outcome based education system, it is when you assess any participant or learner, we should certainly analyze the responses or the, you can say, evaluation that as teacher or as instructor someone has done. So that is why basically it's part of our OBE culture that we have to discuss the responses of the quizzes. Then assessment planning, and assessment planning is a, you can say, very wide, has very wide scope, and it includes so many parameters, and some of them was emphasized and addressed by Professor Mantri in morning session, that we will go through assessment components, assessment methods, assessment tool and tasks. So I'll try to differentiate what actually is the assessment component and the, you can say, contextual as far as our understanding is concerned. But the definitions or the name that is used interchangeably at different places. So what we have used, so or what we have practiced to use, that is what basically we'll be discussing. What are the assessment components? What are the different assessment methods, tools, and then the assessment tasks? So that is what basically we'll be discussing in assessment planning. Then we'll go for the assessment rubric for professional outcome, for measuring or assessing professional outcome. That is basically mandate from the AICT that we have to discuss assessment rubrics for the professional outcome or the attribute that we have discussed yesterday. There are, we can categorize the graduate attributes or the program outcome, and we can broadly categorize those in one is the technical attributes, another is the professional attributes. So that is what basically are the two broad category. And the assessment rubrics, though, we'll be touching upon how the assessment rubric can be planned for even the conventional examination or for assessing the technical attributes as well. So finally, we will be discussing some sample questions and question paper. So that is what the flow would be. So just to recap, though this recap was already in morning session was also presented, but it is the duty of any session presenter that he should recap what has been covered. Even if we are teaching in any course, whenever we go to the lecture, certainly it is a good practice, or rather it should be followed everywhere, that you revise or recap what has been done previously, and then only the things will be better explained. So it is a, well, you can say, established truth that assessments drive learning from where we started, and that is why basically we are, you can say, having this workshop on examination reform, which is largely telling about how the examination or the question paper and the assessment planning, because the educational experience is a collection of the three pillars that we have discussed in the last 2 days. And those pillars are the, you can say, curriculum, then teaching learning process and assessment. And this particular workshop is focused on assessment. Then we have discussed the global perspective of the graduate attributes, from where this program outcome and or program learning outcome have been derived by our NBA or the other accreditation, NAC and all that. So we have derived program outcome or program learning outcome from 12 graduate attributes suggested in Washington Accord. And there are 8 knowledge profile and 7 problem solving profile also listed in Washington Accord. 9 I have put, I have also basically emphasized this, that's 9 I have put because in recent development, the working group of 3 big organizations, UNESCO, IEA and WFPO, they have suggested the 9th knowledge profile, and then you can browse all those things on the IEA website. Then we discussed about the mapping of program outcome and course outcome, and why mapping is required, because we want to assess our student, because our focus of OBE is what student has learned and to what extent he has learned. So there are 2 things: what student should learn and to what extent he has learned. So what student should learn is all about in described in the attribute of program attributes, and then or program outcome, and then it is basically a designing down approach. We also set outcome for each and every activity that is performed in the examination experience, whether this activity is related to the examination or any other activity, even the as I emphasized yesterday also, that even if it is the extracurricular or co-curricular activities, we should set the some outcome, expected outcome of those activity, and that those must be assessed and evaluated, and then finally mapped with the PO, and it should be considered in the final attainment of PO, because that is gives that gives us a, you can say, out of 7, some of the program outcome out of 7 professional attributes. So that is what we discussed. Then we discussed in detail about PO, and then we found that it is difficult to map course outcome directly with PO, because if we go through the courses that we have through different poles as well, it is difficult to map any course with the professional attributes or the professional outcome that is listed in NBA or in Washington Accord. And that is why we have to break program outcome into competencies and performance indicator. And I should revise how basically we have derived the competencies, that is based on the keyword or the characteristics or the attributes that we use, we have used in defining or describing POs. So that is what basically how we can derive the competencies, different competencies, 3, 4, 5 competencies we can have for each POs depending on the attributes or the keywords that we write in PO. And then using the associated activity, activity you can do for that competency that basically is listed or assessed through performance indicator, because to have one particular competency, you may have number of performance indicator that we have discussed yesterday. And then final exercise we did was about the critiquing the performance indicator and competencies, whether they, in your opinion, whether you need some change or you can have changes at your own place in competencies and performance indicator, but they are already listed in the examination reform policy released by AICTE. Then another important aspect that was discussed was related to the OBE philosophy. So I have deliberately put this recap about the OBE, 4 pillars of OBE policy, because while I was going through the poll, I will discuss the responses as well. The one of the question that was related with the, you can say, pillars of OBE, many of you have given the response of high expectations is not part of the OBE, but I have discussed that emphasized number of times that high expectations are really required from the faculty member or teacher or trainer, and it is an important part of the OBE. Then the we have discussed this map. I'm showing this map just because yesterday in chat box I have some request that this map is not you can say was shown for quite longer time. So let me again explain this. We have added the performance indicators and competencies, and the performance indicators are mapped with the assessment, and then COs are also mapped with the assessment, and then only we can map CO. That is what basically is our prime, you can say, each and every faculty should work upon the COs. And once the COs are perfectly written, then only we can have the outcome, a program outcome map with the program outcome, and program outcome can be attained. So let me once again give the detailed, you can say, if we go through the detail of this particular map, that for example PO1 is having 3 competencies. PO1 is related to the knowledge attribute that any engineer should able to solve complex problem using the basic science courses and some engineering science courses and some, you can say, specialized engineering courses. So that is what is the gist of PO1, that is related to the knowledge. And that particular description is divided in 3 competencies by AICTE, that is CA 1.1, 1.2, and 1.3. Then for each competencies, to measure each competency, we have identified the performance indicators. It means if a student is performing this much or that particular aspect, it means we will say that this competency is achieved. And again, to emphasize that merely attaining one of the competency doesn't suffice that particular PO is attained. And that is where again the competency and performance indicators will play important role while evaluating the attainment through whatever method we have, the direct method, indirect method for course outcome, and then the direct and indirect method for program outcome as well. So that is not part of this session or the workshop. So that is why we are not touching that portion. But certainly we have to devise one such, you can say, attainment methodology so that we can specifically see how much or how many competencies have been attained. And that basically for whatever number of competencies we have defined for each PO, all must be attained. The level may be any, that is again separate part or separate discussion is required for that. We are not going to discuss that. So and each assessment question, the the second last yellow block, where the assessment, midterm, end term, assignments, projects, etc., whatever assessment tool you are using for assessing any, you can say, through the question paper that we are setting, or through any type of any assessment that we are setting or designing, then each assessment question should be mapped with performance indicator. And that helps us in mapping CO. If one particular CO is mapped with the question and the question is mapped with performance indicator, then we can easily map CO and PO, that is course outcome and program outcome. So that is what basically is depicted from this particular figure in detail. Then today session, though we have discussed in session one, session two, and then in the 2 day complete session, was on this Bloom taxonomy action verb. So here in that session, the previous one, it was deliberated in length what is how the knowledge based question, how the understanding based question, applying based, analyzing, evaluating, and creating based question we can frame, and how to find or how to judge using the statement of the question that it is related to what Bloom taxonomy level. It was also emphasized in today's session that for assessing the higher order thinking skills, we need to assess the analyze, evaluate, and create. And also we have discussed in detail about the complex engineering problem or the meaning of the complex problem. That is also the solution of complex problem largely require the higher order skills, not the lower order skill. So as engineer, we have to always work for the complex engineering problem and find the solution of complex engineering problems. So that is why we have to focus on during our teaching learning process and during our assessment, so that we can basically give required information through our teaching learning process, which basically gives a student to have the top three levels of Bloom taxonomy level, that is analyze, evaluate, and create. Once we produce or we discuss or try to explain all these three levels of Bloom taxonomy in our class or in our teaching learning process or educational experience, certainly a student will be able to have all that particular, all those attributes and that Bloom taxonomy levels. And once we have everything, then only we should assess. Though we have started from that assessment drive learning, and that means that if we tell in advance that this is how you will be assessed, that you will be assessed for the higher order thinking skills, then certainly it is because at the top, the clarity of focus, if we have that particular thing in mind, and that we are having that because it is listed in PO, program outcome, that is what the clarity of focus tells. It means we should have the you can say the assessment and other thing, or the curriculum and the teaching learning process complete, educational experience should be towards the higher order thinking capabilities. But as it was already explained in today's session, then or it was we discuss in tomorrow's session as well, that when we are training our student or the learner for top three levels or the four levels of Bloom taxonomy level, then the first two or three levels are automatically taken care of. As you will understand, if you have that knowledge, you can apply. If you understand, you can analyze. If you are able to apply, and you will be evaluating only if you are able to analyze, and you can create if you can evaluate. Because when we create, we have number of the solution, possible solutions, and we have to evaluate each and everything, and then we have to finally provide the solution to the problem. So that is what basically we have discussed in our 2 days, 1.5 day rather, yesterday's session and today morning session. Quiz responses, it is very, you can say, well taken quiz, and I'm happy that the median is 8 out of 10 point, and the average is 7.49. So most of the participants were able to achieve whatever basically was desired from that, at that what we set through the our outcome listed, that we have listed in the beginning of the session. OB stand for, almost everyone do it correctly, but those who could not, this particular responses are not only for those who have given the correct answer, but largely it should be, you can say, they should focus more those who are not able to appreciate the question and then give the right answer to this. So what is the primary purpose of evaluating an OBE training system? That is the fourth, almost 50%, more than 50%, almost 70-80% correct opted for the correct answer, that it is not the characteristic of OBE system. Then at the last stage of OBE, what is that we are evaluating? Whether the learning outcome were achieved. So that is the last stage, and then we can rather say that after having that result, we need to focus, and then we need to rather try to improve that if we find something is not, you can say, aligned with the OBE. The most important characteristic of outcomes statement is it should be measurable and observable. Most of you have given the correct answer. India has become its the maximum, I suppose, correct responses. And then anybody, a body responsible for this, it is National Board of Accreditation. We have discussed that it was the requirement from Washington Accord side that accreditation body should not be same as approving authority, cannot be the accreditation authority. And that is why NBA was given this autonomous independent charge, and then only we were able to sign a Washington Accord and become the permanent signatory of that. Which one is the correct flow of higher order thinking skill? Almost everyone given the correct answer, but now after the 2 day session, I'm sure it would be 100%. And which one is not part of four pillar of OBE? So I was not expecting, high expectation would be the you can say choice, because we have emphasized a lot on high expectation in session two, because the OBE is largely because something we are already doing, we are doing enough in curriculum and development, we are doing you can say some a bit in teaching learning process. The assessment is the least touched educational experience that we are trying to have in this particular workshop. So we have discussed that high expectations are required because we want to improve more the teaching learning process, so that we introduce the higher order thinking capabilities or higher order cognitive skills, and that we have discussed number of times. So that was all about the quiz responses, and our team is quite you can say, should congratulate all of you that you have not only responded but also correctly responded most of the questions. So that is, that gives you the idea how interactive and attentive you are during this workshop. So let us start the session. That is, the objective of this session is to discuss the importance of assessment planning and its component for implementing outcome-based education through the demonstration of question papers and its analysis based on Bloom taxonomy, course outcome, and performance indicators. So that is what basically the objective that we have set for this particular session. That what we will be going to do, we'll be going to discuss largely about assessment planning, and that assessment planning we'll be doing through the assessment component and discussing some of the questions. So though the questions and paper was discussed in details in the previous session, so we'll be having very few, you can say, questions to be discussed upon whatever is required for this session. The outcome of this session, after the completion of this session, the participant will be able to design assessment plan template. Certainly we'll be discussing what it is, what is the assessment plan template you may be using in your institutions or organizations from maybe for quite long, but we'll be discussing it again, and that is what the main important part of this session is. Then design an appropriate question paper and its analysis that we have discussed on the basis of Bloom taxonomy and the course outcome and performance indicator. So the Bloom taxonomy is already being discussed in very, very you can say, great detail and depth of through the questions, different questions. Design the rubric for assessment task. That is also, we'll be discussing the different types of rubrics, and I'm sure after this particular workshop you will be able to design these things. You will be able to design the rubric for assessment task as well. So these are the three outcomes, and I'm sure after this workshop you will be able to have everything. So assessment plan, what is assessment plan? Assessment plan is a judicious selection of assessment components, assessment methods for each component, assessment tools for the selected methods, and the number of task activity under each tool. So the terms, you may be finding that there are different terms we are using, but I am sure that everyone is already using these things that we'll be discussing in the coming slide. What are the assessment component, the assessment tool, methods, and all that. So that is a holistic definition of assessment plan. That is it is the selection of the what component we should have for the assessment, what method we should adopt, and the tools that we should have for that, and how many task or activities for each tool. That is what basically, that collectively it is the assessment plan. So I am sure that everyone is already doing it. The suggestive assessment plan should ideally be proposed at and included in the program guide at the curriculum design stage. It is stage. Though I have been basically, you can say, a very strong opinion about this, that the board of studies that we generally have at different, at the institution level or even at the university level, they generally focus on curriculum design only. The most of the board of studies that I have attended, being part of the board of studies and the other capacities as well, it is found that complete discussion, almost 100% discussion, is about the curriculum design, how the scheme should look like, how many courses we should have in each semester, what should be you can say the number of courses, the total number of hours. These courses are, you can say, obsolete. Let us have the new courses and all that. There is hardly any discussion on the teaching learning process in Board of Studies, and there is very rare discussion that I found about the assessment planning. And unless until we discuss about the assessment planning, we cannot have the assessment plan at the curriculum design stage. So if you go through the different syllabi that is available on different websites of the institutions, you will find in that particular document, it is largely about the syllabus portion, how many credits are given, LTP, and so on and so forth. Very rarely that document touch the other two important thing, that is the teaching learning process and the assessment. So generally this is done at the institution level, at the lower level, either some faculty who is teaching that course, he independently sit and decide about the teaching learning process and the assessment. Or otherwise, the other way that is also popular, that it is decided at some central level, which may not be subject expert, that this is what basically assessment you have to follow. So that is not the correct way of assessing or having the assessment plan. It should be discussed. It should become the part of the competent bodies, those who can look into depth of the syllabus or the course or the activity, and then it should be given as a suggestive assessment plan should be given at that stage only. Then only. Why I am using the suggestive word here, but certainly once if it is suggestive, it means we can have minor changes depending on the requirement, the current requirement, or the contextual requirement of that particular batch or that particular course. Or sometimes it may be some of the students are very good, so we may have some other type of assessment plan. That also is part one of the you can say pillar of outcome based education, that we should give the expanded opportunities. If some student is good, we should have something which is, you can say, of his interest. So that was also discussed in the morning session, that we have a student of the varied, you can say, ability. So that is what basically we have to consider the things. It should be reviewed. Assessment plan should be reviewed by the course coordinator before the start of the session and may be modified as per the need through the set of procedure and displayed, shared with the learner. So two important things, that before we start our session, the assessment plan should be designed. If it is some modification is required, that should be done. And certainly it should not be done in isolation. There must be some SOP for that at the institution level. And then it should be shared with the student, the complete assessment plan, not only the how many, what is the internal assessment and what is the end semester assessment or the end of session assessment, whatever name we have for the different. So may I request you to type in chat box, what are the assessment tool you use for assessment of your courses? You can give your responses in chat box. Assignment and quizzes, mid-examination assignment. Good. Summative assignment. Assignment, case studies, quizzes, Google form. Great. So thank you. The responses are pouring in. So MCQ, Moodle, so there are almost, you can say, we are touching many aspect of assessment. One, many you can say tools are being used quite different faculty members for their courses. Thank you very much. We can stop putting this because we have another. You can. We have another chat box response. How many assessment tasks you use for the assessment for one course? So in totality, how many assessment tasks we do for assessing one course? So 2, 3, 4, 3, 3 tasks, 5 tasks. Task means everything that you give as assessment. Whatever assessment you do, MCQ 7, 6, great. So we are getting the responses. Thank you very much for your responses. And it is in general 5 to 7 is, I suppose, is the maximum that we are having. So may I request Shivani ma'am to have the first poll. What percentage is assigned to CIE? CIE here means it is continuous internal examination. What percentage is assigned to CIE, that is continuous internal evaluation or examination? Because if we say only examination, then there is. This is not the quiz, a poll. We have to go for. What percentage is assigned to CIE, that is continuous internal evaluation? Below 60%, up to 70%, up to 80%, and above 80%. That is for project courses. The next poll question that will come for the industrial training. So you can make your mind what response you have to go, you have to give for that before. During that time, I will just basically analyze. Let me, I'm waiting for the result of the poll. No answer is the maximum, that is 509 has not given answer, only about 450 have given answer. So below 65%, 60% is the maximum, up to 70% is next to it, and up to 80% is 98. It's very good, you can say, a number, and up above 80% is 37. That is for the project evaluation. And can we have another polls and we'll discuss it together? That is, if we have industrial training in place, so what exactly is the percentage of marks that we give to the industrial training? These are two major components where we can assess the student on the basis of their higher order cognitive skill if they are doing some project in the industry. Because if we are going to industry only just to have a round of it and to just go through and see the processes, then it is not that way. So below 60% has increased, so it is not good sign, and above 80% is reduced, I suppose, and up to 80% is increased. So that is what basically. Thank you Shivani ma'am. You can close this window. So what we have seen that the percentage of assessment, it's still, you can say, more as end semester examination or the final YOC or whatever, basically the way we are trying to assess the student for these two courses, which are otherwise spending. Just see, in the project course, we are spending a lot of time, and you can say every day we are putting some effort, and it is incremental change is there, some development is there on daily basis, and still we are putting in maximum questions or the responses, we are putting still 20%, 30%, 40%, even 50% to the end semester that we conduct only for 15 minute or 20 minute presentation, or some, you can say, the demonstration or whatever it is. So that is not good sign, basically, if we are trying to assess the higher order capabilities, then it is better to assess on the continuous level at the most. Maximum continuous level assessment should be there. And the same is true for the industrial training, or rather it is more true, should be more true for the industrial training if, only if they are doing some project in the industry. Because when you go, sometimes the industry do not entertain, or sometimes the student also take liberty to not to go there and take only certificates, that is separate thing. But if you are doing your training seriously, though it is again up to us, we know what student have done or he has done anything yet, or not, we can evaluate on that sense. If you want that, certainly it should be the outcome should be, should have clear indication of the attribute of a graduate, then only we can reduce that percentage of unemployed engineer that we are producing. Otherwise we will keep, we'll be keeping this percentage very high. So this particular slide gives an idea, whatever basically you have just polled for the two questions. It is CIE is the continuous and SEE is the end semester or the semester end. As we have more end semester evaluation assessment in terms of marks, certainly we are restricting ourselves to evaluate higher order skill, and we are restricting our student also that they attain higher order thinking capabilities. Otherwise, that is the most essential part or the attribute or the Bloom taxonomy cognitive level that they should have for solving those complex engineering problems. And our target should be certainly to reach this continuous evaluation, maybe those dimmed, you can say, the boxes that I have shown, that should be the target, that we should have 80%, 60 to 80, and up to, in some courses, we may give the 100% weightage to the continuous assessment. If we take a simple, you can say, engineering science course, that is the engineering graphics, where a student is doing everything in the classroom, everything is doing in front of the assessor for complete semester, still we have maybe maximum up to 60% for their continuous work, and we give 40% to the end semester, which is not fair it should be rather 80% or maybe up to 100%. So we have to identify many such courses where we can give 100% weightage to the continuous assessment component rather than for the end semester component. So that is what basically the two component assessment component that we generally use. One is the internal component and another is the external component. More internal component, more you can say higher order thinking skill we can access. We have possibility to assess, we have opportunity to assess that. But again, it is up to us whether we design our assessment in such a way or we design our assessment directly taking some questions from the end of book, you can say exercises, putting them in front of student. That basically won't make our student who will be capable of solving higher order thinking or solving complex problem using higher order thinking skills. So now let us come to the assessment methods. We have discussed assessment plan, the component of the assessment planning. Now the method of assessment planning, that is what basically, again, I have this disclaimer in the beginning also. Again, I would like to reiterate that disclaimer. The name, you may be using something just to describe all those things. The method you may be using as technique, you may be using as the task, but that is what basically we have the practice to use. The assessment components, the internal component and external component, then for each component we can have the methods for assessing those component. So examination is one of the method to assess the internal component. Submission is another, you can say, method for assessing internal and external component. And then feedback, generally we can use this for assessing the informative assessment. In morning session, it was discussed that what is the formative assessment and what is the summative assessment. So feedback certainly we can use for having this formative assessment. And generally we, as some faculty have this habit of having some feedback in between the, you can say, this complete teaching learning experience, and then that they use it for their own purpose mostly. But we can have feedback or type of assessment that we can assess our student, and then we can give the feedback that this is what basically you are lacking and this is what you should focus upon more. So that is in examination section, it's all very intuitive and trivial that we have mid-semester, class test, quizzes, end semester. In submission, we can have assignments, project, case studies, technical reports, and so on and so forth, many other submission type of things you can have. In feedback, we generally use for the course attainment and program attainment, program outcome attainment and CO attainment. And we generally take feedback from the stakeholders. So student is one of the stakeholder, or the learner is one of the stakeholder. So that we can use for many purposes, and that depends on how we have designed our feedback. So these are the assessment methods we will be using, that is examination, submission, and feedback. And the listed items, that is below each and every assessment method, is assessment tool. So we are using mid-semester as assessment tool for examination, and examination as method can be used for assessing the internal component or external component. So that is what the flow that we use here. So we have internal component, external component, then the methods, and in that method we have the different tools. So we can add a number of tools. You can design your own tool, you can have your own way of adding the tools so that we can assess the student in better way. Depends on the course as well. So I request Shivani ma'am to please have this poll, if we have this. Okay, so which assessment method is more capable of assessing higher order thinking skills? Very relevant question, though, because we are largely discussing in our sessions that as an engineer, we have to face complex engineering problem, and for solving any complex engineering problem, whether it is easy or difficult, it is not the point of discussion, and we are not bothered about the easy and difficult problem. We are only discussing the complex problem, and if we have to solve a complex problem, certainly we must have to have this higher order thinking skills. And most of our assessment should be inclined to that. So can I have the assessment result, please, Shivani ma'am? Great, but no answer is still leading. I suppose they may not be part of this session. Only about 450 participants are responding to the polls, and 153 have this submission, and then feedback 127 and examination 140. So it is almost, you can say, equal. But feedback, I don't know what prompted you to take on the feedback, because feedback we generally only take for the summative assessment, formative assessment. The submission we can give through project reports, trainings, visits, etc. So it should be rather 80% I was expecting for the submission, but it is not like that. But the submission is the, you can say, method where we can assess higher order thinking capabilities, because in submission you can put the open-ended problem. In projects we have the open-ended problem. In assignments we can design the open-ended problem. In industrial projects or industrial visit, you can also have the scenario or the experience you can have, and then you can try to assess. So it should be a submission is the right, you can say, response for this. Then we come to the assessment plan template. Assessment plan we have already discussed. It is the complete planning of having tools, methods, and the component as well. So in part A, we can have different tool. We can design how many tasks we should have for each tool. So in this particular slide, we have mentioned that you can have a particular course maybe looking for sharing 5 tasks as assignment. 2 mid-semester tasks may be given. 2 quizzes are planned. 1 fieldwork is planned, and 1 end semester is planned. So it is also mentioned against this quiz FA that we are not considering this for final assessment or for final grading. Quiz, 2 quizzes are planned as assessment task, but they will be only used for giving some feedback related with their, you can say, competencies or the performances. Just to give them feedback that this is the area that you should focus more, and for that you may suggest some books, you may suggest some readings and other things. So that is what basically the part A should look like. And in part B, you have to give the percentage weightage in percentage for each CO, that in total overall assessment. Means overall assessment means or combined with assessment, assignment, midterm, quiz, fieldwork, and end term. If we have everything together, what should be the percentage of the CO that we are assessing in terms of marks? So that is what basically we have to have in the beginning of this semester. We have to review, though it should be part of the your curriculum or the syllabus or program guide, whatever name you give, and it should be part of that, that what is the percentage of COs that will be evaluated. And finally, we should have in part three a detailed, you can say detailed information about the marks and the weightage, that what should be the weightage and what component you are going to assess in your different task. So what does it mean that for example, we have assessment A1, assessment A, assignment A1, assignment A2, A3, A4, A5. These are the tasks that we have opted for assignment tool. Assessment tool is assignment, and for assessment for assignment tool, we are using 5 tasks. Similarly, M1, M2 here representing mid semester examinations. That is we are using mid semester examination as tool, and that you can say method is the examination. How we are assessing it, that is the examination. And then field work is again that was not listed in this the list that I have shown of the assessment tool, but we can have the assessment tool. And then finally, the end term. The COs, one of the query that I could see on my screen, that COs are standard or not, that largely basically it was not part of the discussion of this complete workshop. But let me introduce here, though we have discussed in yesterday's session also, and we have touched a bit in today's session also, how to write CO. And there is one common mistake that we generally do using that basically I am giving this particular sentence in, with reference to the standard methodology of putting the COs, that we should use Bloom taxonomy to list COs. Generally, at almost many places, 90% of the places where you find COs, they are listed on the basis of the content that you are teaching. Content that you are teaching means it is content focused, it is the topic focused. For example, if I am teaching strength of material as a course, then first topic may be stress and strain, second topic may be the bending stresses, third topic may be shear force and bending moment diagram. And accordingly, we have the first CO related to stress and strain, second CO related to the bending of bending stresses, third CO may be for the shear force and bending moment diagram. And that is absolutely incorrect way of writing COs. We can have a full workshop, a full session on this, how to write CO, and we that is, but still it is not part of this. But it is the most important topic, which I generally feel, personally feel, that if we can put the COs in right manner, then certainly most of the problems of mapping is automatically resolved. So that is, that was the one query that flashed on my screen. So it means that CO is to be designed by the course coordinator and while we are designing the curriculum, and it should be approved through Board of Studies or whatever competent body that you have at your place, and then it should not be modified once directly through the course coordinator, unless until it should follow again the set procedure, and then only it can be modified. But the you can say the key concept for writing COs, it should have all it should be written using Bloom taxonomy action verb, and that is what is generally missing from all COs. So as far as this assessment plan is concerned, It is FCO1. We were discussing the mid-semester fieldwork and end term, and we have to basically mark here what percentage that will be assessing for CO1 in assignment 1, assignment 2, assignment 3, and so on. The percentage that we have written at the bottom row, that is the total weightage that we have given in the previous slide of this assessment plan. So that is part A. The weightage that we have decided in part A, that is mentioned in the bottom row, and assess the percentages that we have decided in part B, these are mentioned in the second column, and then in between we should fill, and that should be made available to the student through whatever mean you have, whether it is you are emailing, you are putting some website, you are using some ERP, and so on so forth. So that is what basically the assessment plan is. The most important part of assessment plan, and when I say most important, I mean it, and that is the assessment task template. It was emphasized in the morning session by Professor Mantri that we should write the complete assessment task, and that is what basically I have given this name as assessment task template, and what we should include. And it may not even limited to what parameters I have used here for assessment task template. You can have your own parameter, and that it may vary from assessment task to assessment task, but largely the components that we have taken here, they are almost, you can say, standard, and they are inevitable to be excluded from this assessment task template. So let me explain what exactly this assessment task template is. In the first row, we have assessment method, and assessment method can be, as we have discussed, it can be examinations, assignment, project, report, etc. Whatever we have that we have to write, it is the submissive type or the examination type method we are using. The assessment type means it is the component that whether it is for the internal or the end semester. Assessment nature, we have to briefly describe about the assessment. For example, one example I have taken, it is 2-hour written examination. Required, you will be requiring to solve a mathematical problem covering the class material. So that is what, likewise, you can have your own way of writing this. What is the nature of this assessment would be. It should not be like that when a student sit in the class and he certainly found something which he is not expecting. He was expecting 10 questions, but there are only 4 questions or the 2 questions of some very high difficulty level and the higher cognitive skills level. So that should not be there. We should describe each and everything, what type or what will be the nature of the assessment. Objective of the task, why we are trying to give this task to the assessment, to assessees, the learner, that the objective of the task. Then expected student output, instructions that students should follow while attempting the task. It is not, the instructions here doesn't mean that you have to write only thing that use, you can say, attempt all questions at one place, write the question answers in sequence. So these, you can say, instructions are intuitive and trivial, but we have to write what type of answer we are expecting. So that is what basically a type of answer means what do you expect. So wherever figures required, and somewhere there may be some discussion required, somewhere maybe the, you can say, some your interpretation is required. So that is what basically we have to write for the task. Sometimes it may be more number of, you can say, the expectation that we require from a student, how he has to answer. But largely when we go for the assignment type of, you can say, assessment, There generally we have a one single type of you can say expected outcome. That is how students should write. Then weightage, that is on the basis of the assessment plan that we have. And the most important part of this is the question map that is written in black. That is what is the most important part, and it is given in the examination reform policy that you must have downloaded from the AICT website. And certainly most of you have downloaded, because we have seen through the response of the critiquing of performance indicator and the competencies. So in question map, what you have to do, you should write each and every question, and then the mapping COs, then the Bloom taxonomy level. It is BT level, it is one and same, it's one, it should come in one column. And then the this BT is for the Bloom taxonomy level, and this level we have introduced just to say it is whether it is easy, moderate or difficult level. So that is also should be considered while you are having this your question map and while analyzing the question paper, because it should not be like that it is very difficult in nature or very easy in nature, as Professor Mantri has given the name of Rohan, Renu and Rinku. So it should cater the you can say each and every type, every student, whatever ability they have. We should basically be designing the question paper so that each and every student of different ability can attempt it. And then it is PI, that is the performance indicator, and then marks, whatever marks we are giving to the questions. So that is what we'll be discussing slightly in more detail, but and it should be part of this assessment task template, but should not be certainly showing to the student. It should not be displayed when we are showing this assessment task to the for student use, because that should also be done in advance and should be shared with the students. So this particular portion that is there in black is not to be put there in the task template that we are designing for ourselves. For student, we have to remove it. Then assessment rubrics, specify the marking scheme rubric for each and every question. So it is not like that we can design rubric only for the professional attributes or only for the projects, seminars and presentations that we generally have habit of having. Though most of the faculty members are having some marking scheme, but it is better to more formalize that marking scheme using standard rubric. That also we'll be seeing. If you want to have a rubric for the such type of that, we want to have a rubric for a question, how to have that rubric, that we'll be discussing as one part of our rubric discussion. Then feedback means when student will accept that the assignment or the assessment task will be discussed, or when they can get their checked, you can say, or the marked assessment task, whether it is the assignment or some project report or some examination question paper. It should be given the deadline. That is what basically that is how you are going to get the feedback. Then submission, specify the date and mode of submission if it is required. But if it is examination type of assessment task and the date may not be there, but we can simply say specify that it would happen in second week, third week, or after such and such coverage of the syllabus and so on and so forth. So that we can also list in the course handout. That is also important part of teaching learning process, not for the assessment task. So we will not be discussing a course handout, how to prepare course handout, as it is part of the teaching learning process. So submission, date, and then finally task analysis and remark. that also we should analyze the task on the basis of the CO mapping, Bloom taxonomy mapping, level and performance indicator, that how this particular assessment task is planned. Again, that is your choice whether you want to share with the student or not in advance, but it is up to you. That is that, but certainly it is required for, as far as the assessment task template is concerned. As I have already told that it is the list may be any, some assessment method can be removed, and some assessment method, sorry, these the attributes on the assessment task template may be added or removed. That depends on you, and that may vary from course to course. That may vary from assessor to assessor. That is quite, you can say, it is basically philosophy. When we say philosophy, it is a complete education is a philosophy, and when we add philosophy word, it means it may vary from person to person, and but it is not that it will completely change. It may vary slightly within the permissible limit what an assessee or sometime assessor and assessee think about the educational experience that they have. And similarly, we have discussed this this PI. I just one doubt flashes that what is PI? PI is performance indicator. So this OBE we have introduced as OBE is a philosophy, and we have discussed this philosophy in one way, and that is why you may find someone else is explaining OBE. It may have a different way of explaining it, but the you can say the final form will remain same almost everything. So how to set our question paper on the basis of the discussion that we have in morning session as well as in the today's session about the assessment planning. So I wanted to have one that's poll here, but it may be minimum questions because it is a journal. You can say someone asks how many should be the number of questions in any assessment or question paper, but certainly if we are talking about this, it means we are talking about end semester examination or the final evaluation. But certainly if we are evaluating or assessing or designing a task for continuous assessment, then certainly this first you can say will not be applicable. Minimum number of questions or the assessment you can say task attribute to be equal to the number of COs. So when we design a question paper for end semester examinations, then the minimum number of questions should be equal to the number of COs that we have in our you can say CO statements. So though it is the minimum requirement, otherwise it is not you can say will not be able to assess the course outcome perfectly. So the minimum number of questions should be equal to the number of COs. Add more number of questions to achieve desired distribution of CO, BT and PI. CO stands for course outcome, BT stands for Bloom taxonomy level, and PI stands for performance indicator. So if our CO or the question paper with minimum number of COs is not justifying the Bloom taxonomy level and the performance indicator for assessing the competencies, and then in turn the program outcome, then we have to add some more questions into it. But the minimum requirement as far as OBE is concerned, it should be that we have to have at least the number of questions which are equal to number of COs. Options are given only within the questions of same CO and Bloom taxonomy level. What does it mean? It means that if we are, because each and every assessment is focusing towards evaluating the attainment, course attainment, and as well as the program attainment. So ideally, we should not have any option within the question that out of 8, you attempt 5. That is not basically is going to solve the OBE, going to match the OBE philosophy. And that is why the option should not be there. And suppose we, if we want to give the options, then certainly we should take care that it is within the question of same CO, same Bloom taxonomy level, and above the top, it should have the same difficulty level. So that is what basically we should focus when we are designing a question paper. Assessment questions to map with CO, BT, and PI. We have already discussed the question map. Then the question should map with CO, BT, and PI, and also the level and all possible level of difficulty. So that is what completes the question paper and any assessment setting. And certainly, again, I will be emphasizing that assessment task template is most important document that should be followed, designed, and followed in true spirit. And I'm sure that it will have a very good result as far as the student learning is concerned, as far as your evaluation of assessment is concerned. And as it was again discussed in morning session, that we can add, though it is very difficult to assess the higher order thinking skills through examinations, but still we can involve this higher order thinking skills through open book examinations, through some courses which we can give for the self learning, through MOOC courses where we can ask them to learn, and then either we can evaluate or some MOOC platform, we have the evaluation pattern which is matching the evaluation of our university, that also, or the institution, that also we can adopt from there. So that is what basically is about the setting of the question paper. Then I will discuss a simple example of question mapping, though we have already have had number of examples of questions. I have taken here two very different, you can say, questions, and then we have tried to map with a different type of performance indicator, because that is what the main task is. That this particular, I'm just basically giving you the scenario. I'm not, you need not to even read this statement. If you find it something more, you can say, technical, this is a simple scenario that we have some robot that is basically moving around, and we are measuring the speed of that robot. And that is what basically you can consider is some your vehicle that you are driving. And if you are, we consider that vehicle as a robot, and we are measuring its speed, and whatever voltage we are giving, we have some battery and we are giving some voltage to that motor. So these are the simple things that that is what basically this current scenario is. So we are having this scenario. We have some mobile robot with us, and we are measuring the velocity of that robot, and we are measuring the voltage that we are giving to the motor so that it runs. And we have given some mathematical model that this is how your measurement is taking place, because we are measuring few things. We are measuring velocity, we are measuring some voltage. So that is what basically is something related to, you need not to bother about that. And finally, because of some, you can say, disturbance, the speed is reduced. Maybe some obstacle you are facing in your robo, as we generally apply some brake when some obstacle come in front of our vehicle, and your velocity reduces. And this is this was the question, because this is a question we have just I have just set up in my end semester examination, online examination that we have to conduct due to this pandemic situation. So that is why some trick is given, so that everyone is having a different, you can say, data for solution. Then we have to give some answer on the basis of this model. So if you have this type of question, then this question is basically for level number three, that is the application and analyzing, because whosoever is solving this problem, he has to analyze this complete situation, what is happening here. And model is given, and then this analysis of the model is to be done, and then we have to find out some solution. That is what basically it is. So in this particular problem, you have to write some code, and you have to use some algorithms, and then you have to write the result. So that is what basically the complete scenario is, and that is what is expected from the student, that he will use some programming tool, he will use some standard algorithm, mathematical algorithm, and that is the statistical data, something is given. So all those things he has to analyze, and then he has to apply on this you can say problem, to solve this problem. So I suppose most of you must understood the scenario and why this is under level 3 and level 4, because we have to apply the different knowledge of mathematics and science, and then mathematical modeling is concerned, and some the analysis is concerned. So that is why it become part of level 3 and level 4. Now I will discuss about the PI, performance indicator. I can map this with performance PI 1.1.1. So this is what PI 1.1.1 say, that it is apply mathematical techniques such as calculus, linear algebra, and statistics to solve the problem. So that is what basically is required, and that is why we have mapped this with PI 1.1.1. And I hope you can write in chat box, if you, those who follow this, that why this particular problem or the question is mapping with PI 1.1.1. And then the next basically PI is 2.4.1. So let us see what this PI states. 2.4.1, apply engineering mathematics and computation to solve mathematical model. We have some mathematical model given there, and we have to apply the knowledge of mathematics, and then only this computation can be done. And certainly we have to use some mathematical tool as well as the programming tool. And in programming tool, we have to apply some mathematical equations. Basically, this is the question based on, there are many methods through which this problem can be solved. One is recursive least square method, though it is not to be, I deliberately removed this word from this question, but you can use many other methods as well. So curve fitting, no doubt curve fitting can also be done using recursive least square or simple least square. Some response was coming on the chat box. So that is why this is mapping with this, applying engineering mathematics and computation to solve mathematical model. I hope you all agree that this problem is mapping with PI 2.4.1, and accordingly the competency number 4 of this PO2. Now let us see, I mapped this particular question with PI 4.1.3. Let us see what exactly 4.1.3 says. That it says, it is no doubt, those who remember, this is related with the investigation, research based, and this apply appropriate instrumentation and or software tool to make measurement of physical quantities. So that is what we are doing here. We have given some situation, we have used some tool, software tool, and then we have to evaluate the physical quantity. That is what basically is required in this problem. So I suppose you can very easily map this problem with the research type of you can say example or the PO. So the next PO, which performance indicator, which I map this problem is 5.1.2. So 5.1.2 suggests it is described as create, adapt, modify, extend tool and technique to solve engineering problem. So in this particular case, those who understand the thing a bit, or the scenario, those who could appreciate the scenario, they can understand whenever this problem will be solved, they will be creating their own tool. We have to use some modern tool, like maybe any programming language. Maybe this can be done in through the C, this can be done through the Python or MATLAB programming, or even some inbuilt tool in those programming language. MATLAB is, you can say, vast, you can say tool. We have n number of tools within the MATLAB, or similarly in the Python, these two are the, you can say, nowadays most popular languages, or you can say framework. I generally say it is a framework. We have number of things within that. So that is what basically we are creating, adapting, modifying, and extending tools and technique to solve engineering problems. So that is how you can map a particular problem. It is different. This is a different problem. That is why basically I have selected this problem of I have not basically given the subject name as such. These are the you can say latest subject for this problem. The another you can say tricky problem, or not tricky, a different problem which we may find, you can say, difficult to map with the performance indicator. And in this particular problem, again, you need not to go to read this, go through the complete paragraph of this statement. I'll just basically give you the scenario, the experience that as you can say, if I am the client and you all are engineers, and then I am just basically narrating one scenario and you have to identify the problem. So the scenario is, I suppose you will appreciate this particular philosophy, that I am a client and I want to explain you a scenario, and you as engineer have to give me the solution for that. So I'm explaining a scenario. It is not a, you can say, complicated engineering based scenario. It is general IQ based scenario that basically we are discussing here. We have some, you can say, on floor, we have a grid of 8x8. We have some floor, a room floor, very big room floor, and we have the tiles, 2x2 tiles, generally we find in any, on any floor. And then we have the 8 tiles, in width and eight tiles in depth, or the length, or wide, basically whatever you gave the second dimension. So if we have those tiles, and then we P1, P2, P3, they are mentioned that if I am a robo, I am standing at position P1 once, and I am standing at position P2, and I am standing at position P3. There are three different conditions. As a robo, I am standing at P1, I am standing at P2, I am standing at P3. And I see, when I am standing at P1, I see at that A1 is someone is there at A1. A1 is the, you can say, cell which is not free, it is occupied, something is placed there. Similarly, when I am at P2, I find that the A2 cell is occupied, something is placed there. And when I am at A3, I see that I am P3, then I see A3 is not free to move, because I want to move throughout this floor. But at different places, I see a different thing, and then I find that this is not, you can say, free to move. So in this particular case, you have to use something. It is mentioned you have to assume some parameter, and then you have to identify if there are only three obstacles, then what is the possibility that the other, you can say, cells are occupied or free. So that is what basically, on the basis of the given scenario. So again, it is L1, we need some knowledge. L2, we have to apply that knowledge. And L3, we have to analyze. Again, there is a catch. So that I suppose I have removed this. So L1, L2, L3 and L5, because finally we have to evaluate the different cells. So we can only write L5. We can only write L3 and L5 because as it was discussed in morning session as well as in today's session, that higher level skill requires lower level skill as well. So if we write only here in this particular case L3 and L5, that will also work as far as Bloom taxonomy mapping is concerned. So let us discuss this performance indicator. We need knowledge. I am not going to this slide. We 2.1.3 we have used. 2.1 identify the mathematical, engineering and other relevant knowledge that applies to given problem, because it is a very open-ended problem and we have to identify what exactly we need, which mathematical knowledge we'll be needing, which engineering knowledge we'll be needing, and that is why basically this 2.1.3 is required. 2.4.1 is required, apply engineering, mathematics and computation to solve this mathematical model. That is what basically we need to use some tool to solve this problem, and that is why basically this 2.4.1. 4.3.3 is required, because 4.3.3. Okay. I suppose this is so 4.3.3 represent data in tabular and graphical form so as to facilitate analysis and explanation of the data and drawing the conclusion, because we have to first extract the data, generate the data, and those data certainly once we have some data, we have to put them in tabular form or whatever form it is convenient, and then we have to analyze the data and draw the logical conclusion. So that is why this is also mapped with 4.3.3. So PO1 is for knowledge, PO2 is for analysis, and PO4 is for investigation and research. So that is how we can map the questions. So I've taken two independent question examples. So just to give you an idea how performance indicators can be identified for a particular question. Now we'll discuss a question paper, full question paper. You'll not be going for to discuss the full question paper, rather we'll be taking only three problems, though again you need not to bother about what is there as a content of the question. We have to simply see how our assessment plan template, the question mapping portion is to be given in assessment task template. The question mapping is to be done like this. We have to write the question, marks, CO level. I'm not discussing the CO level here because they may vary from course to course, maybe from the content of the course to the content of the course, maybe the name of the course is same, the content may vary, and so the CO may vary again. The COs generally written by the course coordinator or what or some group of the person who are expert in that course. So accordingly, it may vary. So we are not showing the course outcome here. We are simply giving the CO1 and CO2 is mapped, and Bloom level L1 and L2 is mapped. The knowledge, first question is the knowledge. In second question, we have compare. We simply see the action verb here. Compare is the action verb. It means it must map with L2. That is an understanding. Again, a disclaimer here that some of the action verb, because a lot of research has been done, now the action verbs are keep on basically updating, appending in the list. And if you go through the latest research, you will find there are more than 150 action verbs put together and some action verbs are even overlapping from one level to another level. So it doesn't mean that whenever compare is written, it will always go to the level two. It depends in what context this compare is used. And this is mapped with PI 2.1.2. Similarly, this question number two, we are mapping this with L3 and L5, that is the analyzing. The first question, we have some, you can say data is given, and on the basis of the analysis only he can answer this. And you can see the knowledge level performance indicator and the analysis level performance indicators are mapped with for this particular problem. And the B part, that is again, it is rather we have to evaluate and then only you can answer this. So that is why it is mapping with Bloom taxonomy level 5 and mapping with analyzing, because in an analyzing PO we have evaluation included in this. So that is why it is mapping with 2.2.4 PI. Question number 3, for example, it is mapping with the Bloom taxonomy level 3, that is the applying, you have to apply the concept of general diode or some component for a given situation. And in the B part, you have to evaluate something, and that is why it is mapping with L5. And this is mapping with PI 1.3.1 as far as the knowledge of different our, you can say, basic engineering courses is concerned. And then it is also mapping with 2.1.3 and 2.2.4. So that is what basically the three questions which I use for a particular question paper. That is of, I suppose, basics of electronics engineering. So the complete question paper, we will send you the link of this particular question paper. And in the same folder, that link is already given to you for the drive. The same paper will be uploaded on the drive, and you can then identify those who are from the same field, or even if you are not, then you can see the complete map is there for all 8 questions, 8 or 10 questions, and then this particular data is presented for all those model question paper which we have designed for you. So in this you can see this is the distribution on the basis of Bloom taxonomy level, and we find that it is almost appropriate to consider that it is, if it is reaching 30-40% approximately, the first two level, it is it's supposed to be fine. And this is the mapping of the course outcome. What exactly is the percentage of course outcome we are evaluating? And needless to say here that this percentage should map the assessment plan part B that we had initially. We have this part B, assessment plan part B, where we are fixing that this CO1 will be evaluated for this much percentage, CO2 will be evaluated for this much percentage of marks, CO3 will be evaluated for this much percentage of marks. So that those whatever given in the presentation, that was not for this particular course, that was a general. So I assume that in this for this particular course, the CO map follows this particular distribution. Sorry. And in first three questions, we have mapped PI 1.3.1, 2.1.1, and so on. And a complete paper, other than those performance indicator, these indicators are mapped. If you go through the model question paper given in the examination reform policy document, there is typo mistake that in each and every model question paper, the same PI is mapped, and which is not, neither it is correct technically or nor it is correct philosophically. So that may be the typo error in all model question papers, but here is how we should MAP performance indicator and the course outcome and Bloom taxonomy level. That is another, you can say, arbitrary question paper that for example, because in many of the courses, it is difficult or rather impossible that you add the create type of question. Again, it was discussed in detail in the morning session that it is not impossible, it is rather more difficult. So here I have removed that that for this particular question paper data, we are not, it is not possible for us to have the create type of questions. So that is again the optimum, what should look like the optimum distribution as far as the Bloom taxonomy level is concerned. We are having just less than 40% of the lower cognitive level, or even the we can reduce even more of the understanding, and we can add some percentage to the analyzing and evaluating. So that will be much more ideal case. If we reduce this understanding 30% and add that to the analyzing capabilities, assessment for the analyzing and evaluating, that would be rather more appropriate for today's engineer would be. So that is all about the assessment planning. That was the larger portion of this presentation. And I assume that you will be able to understand the basic philosophy of assessment planning. And I'm sure that you, all of you, are already practicing this assessment planning. And if we can give it a formal shape and the through the documentation, then it would be rather appropriate. So we'll quickly go through the rubric, because it is also important tool as far as the professional attributes, assessment of professional attribute is concerned. So rubric is tool for grading the student performance and learning for a set of criteria and objective. We'll discuss these things in detail, and that will become more clear what the rubric is. And I am sure that you all are already using rubrics for this for these assessment. And even when we go to some mall or some any other, you can say, organization or some service, you can say, sector in office, they have their own rubric form. Finally, they give, you give us some rating. Nowadays it is online, we give rating to the Swiggy and Zomato delivery boys and all that, whatever basically experience. Those, all these things, all those experience are the experience and example of rubric, that we are grading someone on the basis of some predefined parameters, and it should be communicated to the student. And today we'll be discussing something in more formal way, though I am sure that everyone is already aware of, not only aware of, they are practicing and they are encountering this type of rubric in their day-to-day life. So, but still, I'll be giving some formal, you can say, framework for this. So there are four type of rubrics. One is a checklist rubric, rating type, holistic type, and analytical type. Whatever rubric that we generally make use of, that is of the analytic type, and we generally use analytic type rubric for assessing seminar, projects, case study, training, internship, POPOs, feedback, and all that. So the POPOs feedback, generally we go for the rating type rubric, or we can go for rather rating is the more appropriate. But analytical is in general not, you can say, used for PO and POs or feedback type of rubric. So can we design a rubric for conventional examination question? Do we have a poll here, or can you please give your feedback through the chat box? Yes, we can design a rubric. Yes. So So the poll question you can is appearing here. Do you think rubric can help in better performance of a student in assessment? The poll is must be appearing on your screen, so you can poll that. Do you think rubric can help in better performance of a student in an assessment? Yes or no? So so I suppose time is over.
Thank you, Vijay Jadhav sir. Let me tell you that it was a great presentation. I was connected with you even though off in video form, but I was listening to your rubrics presentation for the last half an hour at least. And let me just compliment you, sir, that it was one of the fabulous understanding even I had of this particular topic.
Thank you, ma'am. I suppose the whole you can say. Idea was just to basically make all participants aware and they and to motivate them to use it. So is it some time is left or I have to basically take up to 2:15 or
No, sir, we generally speaking don't put an upper limit. We don't put an upper limit. We generally see the convenience of the speaker because you've been very reasonably long. So it's totally up to you, sir. You got little bit more topic to cover, sir. We are all connected.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. So I suppose it was up to 2:15, 12:15 to 2:15. So I will be covering up to 2:15. I will be finishing my presentation. Thank you. So
yes, sir. Please, yes, sir. Please go ahead. Go ahead, sir.
So first, the checklist rubric. I could not basically connect. Through the analysis, and I'm sure that all of you will agree that the rubric certainly helps us. It basically helps the assessor as well, just to guide their learner how and where they focus, how and where they should focus. Secondly, it depends on the rubric what type of rubric you are using. For an example. In checklist rubric, generally we have only check boxes that it is yes or no. The simple list indicating presence of things that you are looking for. It was there or not. The dish was tasty or not. So like it. So I have taken example from my assessment task template. Whatever parameters I have used in the assessment task template and this particular rubric can be used to the senior authority whether the assessment task template is designed properly or not. So that is what this particular rubric is all about, checklist rubric. And no doubt it is not only the taking the you can say feedback or collecting the rubric responses. We have to have some target. If there are, suppose for this particular rubric example, if I am a reviewer or I have to set target, I will say if more than one is no, then this assessment task template is to be revised. Or I may fix some mandatory parameter. They has to have only green tick. They cannot be red tick. So likewise, we can have our own target. That whether how to use this rubric. So that is what basically is how it is related to one of the you can say activity that we have to perform as an course coordinator. So a second type of rubric is a rating rubric. In rating rubric, we replace those check boxes through grading that I have to rate 1, 2, 3, and this is the most common rubric that generally we follow. But in this particular case, we are only having few characteristic on the left side. That is for rating rubric, and we give the rating for each and every characteristic, or the you can say a performance indicator or performance characteristic, whatever name you want to give to this, and we give some rating. That again, it is intuitively on hit and trial basis, our own, you can say, experience, whatever is presented to us on that basis, basically we are giving some rating, but without considering or without following some set of procedure. So that set of procedure are not with us. We are seeing or having some experience, and on that experience we are giving some rating. The same example is taken that if we have designed, if some faculty member or course coordinator has designed some assessment task template, and as reviewer, if you have to assess whether this task template is correct or not, then this rating rubric can be used. And then again, we have to fix target. If this total rating is, for example, here we have 9 parameters, so 27 is the maximum. If I set a target, if my total grading is below 25, then I'm asking that course coordinator to revise this. So I am using some strict limit, because this is the most important, you can say, educational experience that we should focus upon. And it largely depends on it, how we are assessing a student. So that is why basically, no doubt, on other cases, we can have the slightly relaxed, you can say, target to pass that particular activity or task. The other important, or the fourth one, is the holistic rubric that we can use, or we may use, or we may be using for quite number of time, and it has some short narrative description of characteristic of outcome work, acceptable work, unacceptable work, and so on. Again, the characteristic, the outstanding work, acceptable work, unacceptable work, these can be replaced depending on what exactly you are looking for and what is there that is in your perception. So it is a single criteria based rubric. I will just simply come to the example. So it is holistic rubric for a research paper. We can set criteria and then we score. We are giving the score on the basis of a list of criteria for each and every score. If our criteria, certainly we have to work upon the criteria so that whatever you can say information we are getting, whatever presentation we are having, or whatever you can say assessee is presenting, so that every aspect should be covered in those criteria, so that we can directly see this is where this particular assessment fit, and we will be giving to this. This is where this assessment is falling, we will give it 3. So likewise, we have to work upon the criteria very meticulously. And this is the rubric that you should use. I am basically using this holistic rubric for each and every question which I give to my student in examination. And that is, we have to write each and every criteria, and some criteria we set before starting our, you can say, evaluation. But I have experienced that those criteria sometime I have to modify when I start evaluating the answer sheet or some project work, and I have to add something here and there, and the grading score here and there, so that whatever evaluation we did, that basically is transparent and perfect. There is no grudge from the student side. There should not be any grudge from the student side that it is, you can say, favoring something and favoring that student or not. So it should be transparent. Once you explain this rubric to the student, then student will automatically can evaluate their marks. Why I have been given 5 out of 10? Why I am given 2 out of 10? Why he is given 10 out of 10? So that depends if we can design this type of rubric. This is the most common rubric that we all are using for our project assessment and seminar assessment. So here we have added performance descriptions and scale as well, and then performance criteria in the first column. So that is what basically is the analytical rubric. In what is the difference? I suppose you can now see what is the difference between holistic rubric and analytic rubric. In holistic rubric, we give final grade of one particular assessment. If this assessment is for 10 marks, I will give 5, 4, 3, 2, 1 out of 10. But in analytic rubric, I divide that assessment into the performance criteria. Then more work is to be done so that I can basically decide upon the performance description, and that is, you can say, this more or less similar to the holistic rubric description, but there are many descriptions or the many, you can say, there is list of description in holistic. Here generally we put few things, and so that we can give the scale or directly mark. So this is the slide that is taken from the examination reform policy document regarding communication skill, and there the marks are not given. I have given added this thing, the proficient. Someone may give 8 to 10, acceptable may be given 5 to 7, and need improvement given 1 to 4. And that is why, because we have quite range, and it is the experience of the individual, and that is why we have panels for that. This time, whenever we are using rubric for evaluation, it should not be a single person who will be doing, especially analytic rubric. That is what basically is, and these are the descriptions that we can have for each and every evaluation. And for the design project, we can have this type of rubric, and these rubrics are given in detail in the examination reform policy at the end, in the appendix form for different stages of project. So that's all from my side. As just to quickly summarize this, we have discussed assessment planning, assessment task template was introduced, we have discussed some sample questions, how to map with the performance indicator and competencies so that it is directly mapped with the PO. Then we have discussed rubric, four type of rubric: checklist, rating, holistic, and analytic. And just to close, before closing, I have to read out all these sentences. What should be done? The closure: the OBE cannot be implemented in isolation. We have to align curriculum, teaching learning process, and assessment, else it is merely a data manipulation exercise. That is what basically I see most of the institutions are doing. Though the course outcome are course dependent, but still we can improvise these to limit between 3 to 6 strictly as per Bloom taxonomy action verb. That is what is the most important thing. The next is, the question paper ideally should not have any choice. In case the choice is to be given, it should be between the questions of the same CO and Bloom taxonomy both. Design activities for professional attributes and add as CO in the respective course. That is what is the most important. That is where the third pillar of high expectation comes into picture. Assessment planning is to be done meticulously before the start of semester and must be shared with the learners. Assessment tasks to assess more higher order thinking capabilities. Do check and recheck as emphasized in morning session as well. Rubric must be in place once the assignment is designed, even for fixed hour examination. We can go for holistic rubrication, holistic rubric in that case. And again, I have emphasized it at least 10 number of times, higher expectation is the key to implement outcome-based education. Thank you very much for the opportunity that AICT and Chitkara University has given me to discuss with you all. Thank you. We will be uploading assignment And the that is the link is given in the chat box. So the assignment will also be through the AICT, as Colonel Venkat has already shared with you that they will be also sharing a Google form for the assignment of questions. Thank you very much. I found some questions. That is, performance indicator is decided by faculty. कहाँ पे हैं? Scroll कर. ओहो. Those who have put the questions in chat box, I request them to repost that so that I can see, because it is not visible right now. Scroll down kar do unse. I requested yesterday as well. You can write the questions even in the document and you can share with us. We'll be more than happy to respond to each and every question. And just give the name of that file as question. You can write your question and post on upload on our drive with the file name as question. And certainly the email ID you have to write there so that we can respond. बार को खींच के नीचे करें ना. Yeah, PI is predefined. Sir, would you please send PPT for reference if possible? Sure, I will be sharing with AICT. No problem. That is not the. I suppose how many assignment can be given in a semester, as you have shown 5 for a model. Again, the assigned number of assignment depends on how and what you are going to assess and what Bloom taxonomy level you want to assess. It is largely dependent or may vary from course to course. Even the number of questions in the assignment may vary from course to course. So this depends on what type of course you are teaching, but generally general habit of giving assignment is largely they are more or less, you can say, content based. We have finished one unit, generally we give assignment. That is what the thumb rule, but still you may decide on your own. The thumb rule is once you completed one unit, you give one assignment. That is what the thumb rule is. Okay. Main use of rubric, as we have discussed, it is used to evaluate the performance and give feedback on that basis. Second use is final evaluation. Just see, if we are evaluating project, we can have the rubric for midterm evaluation, and on that basis we can give feedback to the student that this is the area you should work more. And similar type of, you can say, rubric we can use for the even midterm evaluation. I also take example of the quiz that you can use as formative assessment, where we are giving feedback only for improvement. But there are some cases, as project and industrial training and the presentations, where you cannot have a written examination, and where we cannot have written examination or the assessment or the submission, there certainly we have to use rubric for assessment. So that is what the main there are 2-3 points where we can use rubrics. sample question paper link, I suppose, will be shared, though we have shared one drive, and this will be shared by in Google form, if I could understood Colonel Venkat, that he is going to share one Google form with you for tomorrow's presentations. I suppose we have covered almost every query, and certainly you are free to upload the things if something is left through the drive, and we'll be happy to respond to your queries. So thank you very much for your patience and interaction. Thank you.